to turn the weapons which we issued to them to defend the country on the people who issued them.
They believe in consultation with respect.
Matters Arising is the news and current affairs program of the Anambra Broadcasting Service.
Good evening, viewer, and welcome to this edition of the program, Matters Arising. In today's edition, the Anambra State government was recently inaugurated again for the second time under the leadership of Chief Dr. William Obiama Okorike. And we cannot but talk about that event because it was a very significant event in the annals of our history. And to discuss that and so many other things, I have in the studio one who is of the legislative arm of government at the national level. I'm talking about a member of the House of Representatives. He is representing Anambra there, specifically Orumba North and South in the Federal House of Representatives. I am talking about Isin Gideon. I am talking about someone who has been commissioner in Anambra State, who has been a special aide to the governor of Anambra State, and someone who has gone to the National Assembly. He was, in fact, the 5th, the 7th, and 8th National Assembly. I am talking about someone who has been one of the 4 legislators from Nigeria that were elected into the International Association of Parliamentarians for Peace, a very rare breed. I am talking about someone that is grounded in Nigerian politics, Anambra politics. I'm talking about someone that is intellectually endowed. I'm talking about Chief Honorable Ben Mangbo. You're welcome to our studio.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I remember your host on the program, give up the same. Just relax and watch. Honorable Mangbo, we recently had the second inauguration of Governor Obiama and his deputy. I am sure you were there. Can you tell us what you saw and what you deduce of it with regards to the turnout, with regards to the caliber of personalities, with regards to the programs and policies that were initiated on that day?
Well, thank you very much for having me here. And thank you, viewers. Thank you, Danamara. The inauguration of the government, the second inauguration, as we witnessed last Saturday, it was an epoch event. Landmark, significantly different from other inaugurations. From the perspective of the kind of consensus that has been built around us. And I think it has a direct connect also with the election that took place, the plant in the end of November 2017, in which the government won in every local government in the state. It has never happened in the history of Anambra State, not any state that I know of. Therefore, looking at that inauguration, you will see that the inauguration was widely attended. In terms of qualitative analysis of the function, you see people from all walks of life, from all political lineages, almost every party in Nigeria was represented. And people from the north, from the east, the west, south, they were there. In fact, you could see that you will see a reflection of miniature Nigeria in that event. And what does it say about the government? It is somebody that has done absolutely very well. He knows his audience, he's connected with the people, he has done exactly what he said he would do, and he has been returned to go back and consolidate on what he has done and take Anambra State to the next level. I think, and somebody speaking, that event from any subnational government. That's the best we ever get. We do not have actually.
Yeah. Okay, you have spoken generally as someone that's analyzing the situation. But I want you to look at it as a politician now and the position of the Africa's talk. Some people were saying that the attending of that event by mostly PDP governors around was giving a kind of, you know, signifying that maybe Abga will eventually take over the states around. Some were also saying that maybe they want to have the governor on their side. I don't know whether they want to give the political cooperation.
I think my own political observation is rather on the other side. Watch the tail. The tail is not what we talk.
Yes.
The dog. The attendance by mostly PDP governors, I think, is to say generally that, well, I think that if the umbrella is broken, that we have protected, we have protected in Abra. I talk about the southeast, for example. Most of the governors also in the southeast. We are there, but one, I think, showing also that Abra is the home of southeast. The ideological drive of Abra, which is captured in Onyara and being a Rastafari, is what I think attracting people to the party. And naturally, I see the party expanding across the southeast Nigeria. That is what I mean by the next level, taking the party to the next level, taking the state to the next level.
Right. Yeah, before, when we were starting, we were talking about this political performance that led to the Tutuan that has come to be in Nigeria today. Can you still cast your mind back into that 4-year term and recollect some of the signature projects or outstanding policies that you think made the government to get the cut of people of our state?
Well, I must tell you, before I say this, I have to leave this background. One, I have known the governor over the years from afar, and I've just known him very closely of late. But at the same time, I have been watching in, from an independent perspective, his understanding of the art of governance, his delivery, his policy, the content of the policy, and the drive, the policy drive as well. But before I go further, I'd like to tell our viewers that I am not a police singer by training, by tradition.
Yeah.
So my opinion is going to be very professional.
Of course.
And I don't fear being contradicted in that opinion. Yeah. As somebody that has consulted for Governor's Forum, as somebody that has been involved in peer review activities across that system of the state, across that space of the federation, and as somebody also who is knowledgeable with due respect in the art of measurement and evaluation.
Okay.
I think that what we have witnessed in the past 4 years is simply spectacular. I see a governor who understands what development is all about. Is a mix of what is development, advancement, and growth in so many ramifications.
Yes.
It is not seeing development from point of view of physical infrastructure alone. When you see significant improvement in physical infrastructure,
yes.
Human infrastructure, social infrastructure, economic infrastructure, and then the fiscal government, the general fiscal governance of the state is important to start in that. You look at the financial sensitivity analysis of the 36 of the Federation. The only the first outstanding viable state that is not oil producing is Anambra State. And that tells you about what I am talking about, giving an independent and professional opinion about the 4 years. The man's performance is very seductive, and very seductive to any person who is watching the progress and development on growth in the state. In the sense that the state is being put together. The quality of delivery of its projects, including social deliverables, are absolutely different. He's also someone who is people-driven. His development is people-centered. And also, he has this taste as economy. First, you must look at the child's face before you eat 40,000 in his hand.
Yes.
Good. Now, this is somebody who knows about qualitative program delivery. And as long as what is best for my people, it's not just going to do road, it's not just going to do hospital, it's not just going to build educational institutions. The other day I was at the State University for the ceremony. Mm-hmm. I was really impressed what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and the speed of development and growth there is very fantastic. And finally, in all this issue, in the past 8 years, I've been an advocate of fourth tier like communities,
yes,
as the top tier. Whether it is former top tier or informal top tier.
But you
discover that in the social and economic sector, that somewhere the communities, we are wobbling.
Yes.
But they have been put in the context of governance and truly seen significantly as a fourth tier of government.
Yes.
Although in an unwritten,
yes,
in an unwritten, yes, constitution,
yes,
there is development touching every community in Anambra State without exception. It has nothing to do with the political choice. It has nothing to do with priority of the state government, but instead, the priority of the state is to make sure that every community has a priority project. That has brought down development. And if you know about development, you see that it is the best approach to development is bottom-top
approach. Yes.
And that is what the government is engineering. So he is re-engineering development in Anambra State, and there is a significant paradigm shift.
Yeah, thank you, Ben. One listening to you will actually think that you have been very, very close to government. For Via Abda, it's still Chibuem Nwankwo, member representing the North and South Federal Constituency at the National Assembly, a member of the Tertiary Education and Services Committee, a member of Monetary Safety and Services Committee, Privatization and Commercialization, Consult and Exercise Committee. Now, Honorable Nwankwo, all these committees where you belong, it's like you ask them to choose them because you happen to be from Anambra State, you happen to be from the Southeast, and Southeasterners are predominantly people into commerce, into industrialization, into importation, into privatization and education. So how have you been able to make some imprints in the legislative arm of government with regards to making sure that our people are no longer chased about when they want to import goods, they are not being hounded in their stores instead of checking at the borders? You know, and things like that. I want you to let us know how your activities have been with regards to your committees.
Well, I must say that as a co-legislator with some years of experience, and having been to the Green Chambers 3 times from Anambra State, you know what that means. The understanding at all. The job of a legislator actually is not to execute any program or project of any kind,
of course.
But your job is to, one, make law, two, be sure that government, you give government concurrence in what they are doing by way of oversighting what they are doing, disagreeing or agreeing and making sure that they are operating within the ambit of the law and the budgetary provision for the fiscal year in question. So now, stepping down to what we have been doing, I think that generally speaking, the trouble with Nigeria is that we are failing in creating opportunities by the day. We allow economic space to be contracting. We allow the social and political space to be contracting. And it's not creating opportunities, especially for the younger ones. You have just mentioned, how does it translate to making doing business easy?
Yes, it's a doing business.
Especially for Southeasterners who are predominantly traders and who trade not necessarily within Eastern jurisdiction,
yes,
but outside.
Yes.
In fact, in this online world,
yes,
you discover that it's very unfortunate and it is paradoxical that most of Igbo traders find it easier doing business outside Nigeria than doing business in Nigeria.
Tomorrow.
That is why. Why do I say that? Someone is looking for a shop in Alaba or any part of Lagos. Increasingly by the day, you're making it more difficult,
yes,
for him to get a shop.
Yeah.
And when he gets a job, the shop, he is daily, or he is subjected to daily harassment.
Exactly.
Now, in that circumstance, it has amounted to repression.
So what is National Assembly doing?
When it has come to repression, when you are repressing him,
mm-hmm,
from repression, it will graduate to frustration, from frustration to agitation.
Yes.
Now, what I think that we are trying to do is to rebalance, doing some rebalancing in the laws.
So
most of the laws that we are operating here and there, we are inherited degrees, but every degree is inherited by the National Assembly.
Okay.
And most of the laws out there have been promulgated some of them more than 20 years, 30 years old. So in very many areas, where they are being renewed, are being brought up to speed with present realities,
okay,
yeah, to make things a little more, especially for every Nigerian who is doing business in any part of Nigeria, to see that, to be seen as a Nigerian,
yes,
who is in his own
land,
country, and who should be protected by law, and who should not be intimidated, and who should not be seen from his facial look, his tribal mark, or the type of cap he is putting on, is very, very important.
Now, that's a very good way of going about it. Well, let's go to the tertiary education thing. Recently, we lost a gem in Nigeria, and that gem happened to be from Anambra State. I'm talking about late Dr. Alex Ekwueme, former Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And he was a champion of education. He brought the Federal Polytechnic Group to his community. You happen to have also been part of it. I don't know, when you belong to a community like this, what have you been able to say or do with regards to making sure that the tertiary education is... when I talk about the intermission and then Anambra State and even your own constituency?
Yeah, I would like to take it from the micro level, which is my constituency.
Okay.
Dr. Alex Ekwueme was not just a Nigerian. He was not a normal Nigerian.
Yes.
would say that Benjamin totally different.
He was
one of the most educated minds on the surface of Africa. And that being the case, he brought education down to his people early enough. Yeah. And that manifested in form of Agbata High School and the then Anambra State Polytechnic, now for the Polytechnic. And after his death, you will realize that there was a bill I brought before the floor of the House for that Polytechnic to be upgraded to a Polytechnic, to a Federal University of Technology, and named after him. I have written, for that reason, I've written the executive through the Vice President, and I have his reply. But unfortunately, during his death burial, there was an announcement renaming the Federal University after him. That was ambush to that day. But then, as an experienced legislator, I have gone back to the drawing board to come up with the idea of Polytechnic University. As a matter of fact, since Nigeria, we are battling with the issue of the disparity between BSc and HND. The best thing to do is to, in every geopolitics, let us transform all the federal polytechnics to polytechnic universities. We can take a step-by-step approach so that it doesn't become too much. We'll start with one zone, one federal polytechnic university. They should be able to do diploma programs, then do B.Tech, then do masters and do PhD, but in predominantly the core science and technology areas.
Yeah, I won't allow you to go to those kind of numbers. So let's go still to the federal level. When people hear that you are members of the National Assembly, they do expect a lot of things from you with regards to what you bring home. But then you have explained that what you are measured to make laws. Now, in making laws, despite that the fact that we've had uninterrupted democracy since 1999, but there seems to be this hanky-panky still there with regards to synergy between the legislature and the executive camp, especially at that national level. A case in point is the new the electoral law, the amendments to it. With regards to the reordering of the elections, it was taken to Mr. President and he said he wasn't going to sign it to law. How are you to handle that?
Yes, I must say, first of all, Mr. President has not done anything wrong.
Yeah.
He has simply exercised his right by not assenting to it. But that it doesn't stop there. But before I go further on that, I tell you the problem we have with properly locating the place of legislative institution within the political framework of Nigeria.
Mm-hmm.
Nigerians have not come to terms with that because we have operated the country for too long a time without a parliament. We're used to hereby people are promulgating decrees. Just like people suffer jet lag, we still have a military lag, some kind of permission to use that language. And there is still some vestiges of absolutism in certain people. They have not been able to shake off that culture. Yeah, the country passed through a traumatic period and there was no acculturization before transitioning to civil. So it's a continuous process. I hope that it will continue to run and run. Then talk about what you bring home. The legislative work I have conceived to be a messengerial work, whereby you take the feelings, the message of your people to the federal government, and then bring back whatever the outcome of that by way of a presentation to your people. It does not necessarily that mean that you can't attract, projects. You, of course, what are you there to do? What is politics? Politics is the act of determination of who gets what, and it is defined precisely in budgeting. And that appropriation is within the domain, almost exclusive domain of the parliament. And through that, we have been trying to
negotiate.
Not to be negotiated, because in the constitution says that the resources of the Federation shall be evenly distributed across all parts of the Federation in a way that balance and consensus should be achieved to make governance easy and to make to reflect secularity and in a plural.
Will you think that that balance is being maintained now?
There are so many imbalances socially, economically, and politically. But I guess the time will not permit us to go into that.
But I want time to permit us to talk about, because people at home will be saying, we brought them up, we asked them about Jumbo Pay. This Jumbo Pay is issue. How do you react to that? A lot of Nigerians feel that 13.5 million naira per month per senator, and almost close to that, I think 12% for member of national member of the House of Reps, is just too much an allowance. Is there any atom of truth in that? If it is, do you justify it?
Well, I will tell you this with every sense of duty, responsibility, and morality. The most misunderstood institution in Nigeria is the legislative institution. Because of the seeming altercation between the executive and the legislature. And most of the time, the thing that the best thing to do is to blackmail me before the Nigerian public. So there is no place in the world. And it doesn't also make sense. We are 360 in the green chambers, 109 in red chambers, and you're paying every member of the lower house, you said approximately 12 million naira a month. Except if they pay that to some members and don't pay it to others. I don't take home as a person 12.something million naira. And I have found this so difficult. It has gone into the minds of people that you can. What is that they have not been able to differentiate between what is my pay and what is the cost of running my office. Perhaps you are going for a site function and the ticket is booked for you. You're making international travel, a ticket, you have to pay for your flight, and then if you're entitled to this account, you are given. If you have to have a condition, yes, you get. For instance, I have just one official car given to me by National Assembly. Not more than one. No Nigerian would believe that it is true, but that is true. I can put myself on that oath and say this and hold my head high that I don't have more than one car that is worth more than 2 million naira, as they would say. Neither do I take home or any person that I know of 2 million naira. It does not make sense when you add them up. It does not make sense. But again, let me somebody say that what happens is that a legislator is the only person that is very accessible to the people, and people have to assess you if you are a true legislator, and you have to do their business, you have to handle their social issues you have to dispense some things. Yeah. Most of the time, most people are over-pressurized to the extent that they can go out of their way going to ask for famous outside. Go to anywhere they can. Maybe ministry, for example, mm-hmm. to say, oh, please help this person, do this for this person, if you can do this at least. And I think it is also not out of place. And over the years, we have battled with conspiracy projects. Conspiracy projects, I don't even understand. People think that it is the legislator who goes to execute it, that they are giving money to go and do a conspiracy project. People don't understand that it is what you are able to insert into the budget for a particular constituency that is called conspiracy.
The way you are monitoring it, people think you are going
You never know legislator can execute the conspiracy
project. Well, sir, now I wish time would still allow us, but it's not there anymore. In the last 28 minutes or thereabouts, I've been talking with members representing Orumba North and South Federal Constituency, Chief Honorable Ben Wanko. Chief Wanko has spoken on the second inauguration of the Governor of Anambra State, issues concerning the committees where he belong. He has explained to us the duties of the legislator with regards to what they do and not actually. And I'm very happy that people listen to him. He has dispelled a lot of rumors we've been having. And I hope that when next we invite you to this program, Mr. Wanko will be able to come. We want to thank you for giving us your time on that matter arising. Thank you.
Thank you very much again. We here enter the economy. It's our duty to put every hand should be on there to build up Anambra State alongside the government.
Thank you.
All hands on there.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name remains Gabe, or as they say, thank you for watching.